Jesus, you are the living light who transformed darkness into light. Through the blessings of this glorious Sunday, make us worthy to praise you with all those who saw the radiant light of your resurrection. We worship and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the Church and her children.
Thank you.
our prayers, and may we become a sweet fragrance to our good works and actions. Hear our petitions and grant rest to our departed in your dwelling place of joy. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Hallelujah.
listens. He hears.
Before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and we ask for your mercy.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The evangelist Luke writes, Jesus came to Jericho and intended to pass through the town. Now a man there named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector and also a wealthy man, was seeking to see who Jesus was. But he could not see him because of the crowd, for he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore tree in order to see Jesus, who was about to pass that way. When he reached the place, Jesus looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, come down quickly, for today I must stay at your house. And he came down quickly and received him with joy. When they all saw this, they began to grumble, saying, he has gone to the house of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, behold, half of my possessions, Lord, I give to the poor. And if I have extorted anything from anyone, I shall repay it four times over. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a descendant of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. This is the truth. This is the truth. Peace be with you. Because this man is also a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. In the great question of charity and love, this relationship that God desires to have with each of us, he is always in the initiative. He is always the one who presents his love and manifested historically in the death and resurrection of the Son. And then he awaits each of us individually how we respond to that love. Some respond not at all. Some respond on occasions. And some respond all the time and quite faithfully. Their love is returned and you have the full image of what love is meant to be. Love for love, reciprocity, friendship, attachment, union. For others, it's that wayward child that calls you maybe once every 3 years. Maybe. Or maybe just once a year. Or maybe the child who only shows up for Thanksgiving or Christmas. They're always our children, but they're not around very much. That affection doesn't seem to be too much present. This is the meaning what our Lord says of Zacchaeus, for he's also a son of Abraham. Genetically, Zacchaeus was a son of Abraham just as much before he climbed that tree as he was at the moment when our Lord said, says he is the son of Abraham.
And the connection is that Abraham's story is a story of conversion, turning toward. When we think of conversion, we're always thinking about changing religion. But conversion means continually turning toward the Lord God. And therefore, conversion is fundamentally an idea of what do we love? When we love, we communicate. When we love, we're in union. And so being a son of Abraham is distinct, for example, in the gospel. When Nathanael comes to see our Lord, he is brought at the beginning of the gospel. And our Lord looks at Nathanael and he says to the people around him, here is an Israelite who is without guile. He's referring to the fact of Nathanael's relationship, not to Abraham in this case, but to the law of Moses. This man is faithful. Without guile, simplicity, straightforward. But here our Lord points out Zacchaeus of Abraham because of Abraham's aspect of conversion. We may forget the fact that Abraham's story begins by Abraham stepping out of his pagan family, leaving behind the idols. He leaves behind his family, not because it's his family, because there is a higher love, which is God Himself, infinite charity, the hidden one. And the first conversion of the turning of Abraham is away from the idolatry of the diverse gods of southern Mesopotamia at the time, and turning towards the Lord God. This is why in our Syriac prayers, which I was discussing this with our subdeacon Steve this morning, one of the aspects of the spirituality of our tradition is always the notion of church, always the notion of community. So we're always praying for the dead. Almost all of our prayers include this intention. But what we also have included continually in the anaphoras, in the Busoyeh, in our prayers, in Ramsho, in Safra, we continually have this phrase of prayer that we pray for those who are near and for those who are far. Zacchaeus had been far. He called Mom on Mother's Day. Maybe to make her happy, he took her to lunch on Mother's Day. He might even have gone to Mass that Sunday for Mom. And these things are not bad, but it means that they are far. And Zacchaeus was far. We're told by St. Luke that he was the chief of the tax collectors. He was probably the regional manager for the collection of taxes for this part of Judea. And he is very wealthy. Now, the tax collectors, to use the old term, we always call them publicans. These are the public officials. And they were considered by the population to be public sinners. They were disliked not just because they were collecting taxes. That, to this day, is still an unpleasant aspect of our lives. But also the fact that the way the tax system was set up, and the way the taxes was gathered, it was very much open to extortion. And so when St. Luke tells us that he is a very wealthy man, he's reminding us of the fact that his wealth is mostly ill-gotten, and he is very much a public sinner. What is also interesting in this gospel is that it is unique to the gospel of St. Luke. This story is not recorded in any of the three gospels. And also the fact that we are given his name, which means that this man probably went on in this love relationship with God, of his fidelity, he was known to that first generation of Christians. He remained faithful. It's like in the way of the cross, in the gospel of our Lord's Passion, we are told this man, Simon of Cyrene. And in the gospel of St. Mark, we're told of his son's names, of Rufus. Because clearly the sons of Simon of Cyrene were known to the people, at least of the city of Rome. And so the gospel mentions their name. Oh, by the way, remember when Zacchaeus did this before. This was the beginning of his return from afar to being near. to moving away from God, to accepting God's love, because of course God is constant, His love is always present to us. The division between what we call sin is out of what we choose to do in our lives. And so when we're told by St. Luke that Zacchaeus desires to see our Lord, he's already on the road. He's already moving in the right direction. And so that what this lesson teaches us is that God will require of us sometimes great things, sometimes things which are embarrassing. And so here is this very publicly known figure who's held in contempt by most people as a publican, jumping along the crowd trying to see our Lord, because we're told he's a short man. He can't see our Lord. Which means he's probably pretty short, because we know from the Shroud of Turin that our Lord was 6'1". So if our Lord was probably head and shoulders over most of the people at the time, still can't be seen. We don't know how short Zacchaeus is, but it's obviously difficult for him to see over the crowd. He climbs the tree and hangs out over to see our Lord coming down this roadway. What is also important is to understand the context of this gospel, chapter 18, chapter 19 of St. Luke. As always, I encourage you to go back and read the full context. But as our Lord comes to Jericho, you know the story well because we read it in Lent, is that when our Lord arrives and is coming toward Jericho, he comes across the blind beggar, Bartimaeus. Now Jericho is also an important aspect of this gospel, because Jericho was basically the resort town for Jerusalem. It had all of the connotations that we have for any resort town. Money, wealth, leisure, better or less morals, depending upon who was there vacationing. And because Jericho was that oasis in the desert outside of Jerusalem, it always has, in the gospel, the important reference point of being the world. And so when, for example, the parable of the Good Samaritan, the man who is waylaid is coming from Jericho, he's coming from Jerusalem to Jericho. He's leaving the holy city and going to the Bahamas. He's leaving a place which is clearly sacred to a place which is more self-oriented in our vacation and recreation time. So this is important, because the context will give us, before and after our Lord's meeting with Zacchaeus, is first the meeting of the blind man. And our Lord asks him, "What do you desire for me to do?" "Lord, that I may see." And this is always the beginning of conversion. This is that moment when we reach middle age, when we realize that our parents weren't the idiots we thought they were when we were 17, and we begin oftentimes to rebond and to reestablish communications. That's the beginning of conversion. We first see God has been here all along. I have been surrounded by beauty and goodness and love, and I have been too self-centered to hear it, to see it, to pay attention to it. And so we have the healing of the blind man to be able to see. And what's going to take place after this meeting with Zacchaeus is our Lord gives the parable of the talents. The word is actually menas. But he's giving money to his tent. In the parable, the king gives to his servants, he distributes his money, and he leaves. And when he returns, he expects to find an increase. How did you invest it? What did you do with it? How did you benefit my estate? And of course, we famously have that one of the servants doesn't do anything with it. He doesn't destroy it. He hasn't lost it. But he only gives back to the king what he got. And in the parable, the king is furious. "You knew that I was demanding. You knew that in my exigency I was going to require more than simply to return to me what I gave you. My talent that I gave you, the wealth that I gave you was committed to your care to make it increase." And in that point, that man is cast out, he is imprisoned, and the money that he has is given to the servant who already has the initial money plus the investment, and he's given more. And when the other shake their head and they say, Lord, he already has all that wealth and you're taking it away from him. And the king returns by saying that for those who have much, much will be given, and to those who have little, even that will be taken away from them. It's a very stringent, very demanding parable. But obviously what the lesson is that God gives us a certain amount of time where the king is gone. But he is very demanding that what he gives us in talents and grace and gifts, not just to be returned to him, but returned to him multiplied. And then we're told after this parable, our Lord goes on to Jerusalem. So between coming to Jericho, the place of the world and its leisure, its wealth and its attention mostly to itself, and the holy city of Jerusalem, we have the blind man, the parable of the talents, and in the center we have today's gospel of Zacchaeus. And when Zacchaeus climbs up on this branch of a tree to be able to see our Lord looks at him and calls him by name. Zacchaeus, you've got to come down now. I'm staying at your place. Hopefully there's dinner. And when he comes down, of course, what Zacchaeus realizes at that moment, and he's thinking, this is kind of embarrassing. I have to do things. I have to go to confession. I have to make an effort to transform my life because I've not been in a good place. I need to go better. And when he thinks he's making all of these sacrificial efforts to come and see our Lord by climbing up to see him in the city in Jericho, he realizes our Lord's been waiting for him the whole time. Zacchaeus, come down. I'm coming to your place tonight. And because of the fact of his public status, public sinner, the people murmur. You can't believe this famous rabbi now is going to go to this equally famous, infamous sinner's house. And yet at that point, Zacchaeus professes the transformation of his life. And he says, Lord, I give half of everything I own to the poor, which is much more than tithing, 10%, which was the minimal norm of the law of Moses. And if I have defrauded anyone, if I have extorted anything, I will return fourfold. Now, what he's telling you in this public confession is that, in fact, I have been a thief and I have stolen. Because the fourfold is the law of Moses. And he's very clearly saying, I have been a thief in my life. I have taken. I have wealth. I have a most magnificent patio and pool in my backyard. But if I've taken anything, so he's going to give away half of everything he owns to make reparation, to correct and to repair is what reparation means. And to those specifically that he's stolen from, he's going to render four times what he had taken from them. So this is a tremendous conversion. This is not only the idea, I really like to be faithful. This is the idea of what is required from, I know that it is not a good situation that I'm in. He begins to make the movement to our Lord, and he makes his confession of where he's at. But of course, the future is part of the timeline that we live in. It's not just the past and the present transformation, but of the future of how I'm going to live. Which is why he makes that reparation of half of his goods and fourfold being paid. So this is a wonderfully encouraging story in the sense that we have to realize that even when we're making our own little efforts to go forward, we should be encouraged to know that our Lord is already waiting in the street for us. Climb the tree, make the effort. But we realize that the whole time that we are making our little efforts, God has been waiting all the time. And so what we pray for this day is for the grace to be able to see. To see where we are at personally in our lives. To see where the beauty in God and grace that surround us necessarily all times of our lives, where we could be in this Christian life. And we pray for the strength to not only recognize and see where we are at this present moment, but for the strength and the will to move forward, to correct, to make reparation, and to change the things in our lives to go forward as Zacchaeus does. So this is the beauty of this conversion of Zacchaeus. And when we do this, then we go from being those who are far to moving up the tree of Jericho to become one of those who are near. May God surround us in His beauty, transform us by His grace, and bring us into that proximity and nearness. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We believe in one God,
Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from God, begotten and not made, consubstantial of our God. Through Him all things made, for us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit, was incarnated in the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, He was crucified upon the cross. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will not have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is the Lord and the Lord of life, who has spoken to our hearts. We believe in one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We confess our baptisms for the forgiveness of sins, and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Grant them life in your kingdom.
Amen.
Remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us. We recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God and added to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, St. Joseph, her spouse, St. Mary, St. Jude, and St. Sharpan. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the repose of John's statement. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Glory and thanks to you now and forever.
Amen.
seen.
It is right and just.
Truly it is right and just to glorify and praise you, O God the Father, for you are holy and the giver of life. You are blessed with your only begotten Son and your living Holy Spirit. You are surrounded by the cherubim and seraphim, who sing with pure voices and heavenly melodies. They cry out, glorify and proclaim.
Have mercy on us.
Let us stand with reverence as we pray.
Mani Moriyo, Mani Moriyo, Mani Moriyo, Nitte Moriyo, Haru Kadisho. Ona Vena Lainwa Kurbo. So that none of your faithful may perish. Rather, make us worthy to live by your Spirit and lead a pure life. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
We offer you, O Lord, this divine sacrifice for your church, especially for our fathers and shepherds, Francis the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Estrada Peter, our entire Patriarch, Gregory John, our Bishop, and all the Bishops of the True Faith. With blameless lives and with purity and holiness, may they guide your church and present to you a faithful people who honor your name. We pray to you, O Lord.
Especially those that have presented these offerings, forgive them that they may always live blameless lives in your presence and recognize the blessings that you bestow upon them. For you are good and rich in graces, we pray to you, O Lord. Stand for justice and establish peace. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all who pleased you from the beginning, especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Mary, St. Sharba. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers of the true faith who have endured sufferings for the sake of your church and your people. May we truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed who have left us and have gone to their rest loving you, awaiting their life-giving voice calling them to life. Accept the offerings we present to you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O Lord, to be pardoned, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, forgive us and forgive us, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was in the night, shall be forever.
You're
we, your lowly servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and holiness, and to call upon you, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Yes, O Lord, lover of all people, deliver us from the evil one and from his deceitful ways. And do not forsake us lest the temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bow our heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake, and receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in these divine mysteries with purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy. We raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen. Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy things for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. Give him the glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your
May our
communion be with the forgiveness of our sins and the
thank you, Lord God and Father. And we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and for the glory of your holy name, and that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you. Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake. And by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.